got to ask you a question. The first part of last week, did you ever know a more beautiful weather, fall? And then Friday came, right? Now, none of you complained about Friday, right? No? Why? Well, we take it all as it comes. But today is another beautiful day, so we'll rejoice and be glad in it. Hey, so glad that you are with us this morning, and we come to worship the Lord. And I can't think of a better way to do it than just stand together and sing at Calvary. Page 245, and let's stand as we sing together. Amen. Thank you. May be seated, Brother Bill.
Good morning, everybody. Look out here and see what a fine group we've got. Friends, family members, and visitors that just we don't know well enough to become family members yet. We want to welcome you all. And so we'll get on to our announcements. December's meal will be on the second Sunday before our concert. More info to come. Help still needed with the costumes for the Christmas play. Ladies' Bible study continues to meet every other Friday morning at 10 a.m. Our next gathering will be Friday, November 17th. Hope for Appalachia, November. They're asking for flashlights and batteries. Any questions, please see Matt or Tanya. And the grace boxes are due November the 12th. And we'd like to thank everybody that's participated in that much needed program. Just want to make a couple of personal announcements, I guess. We were doubly blessed yet again. We found out this past Monday that my wife's final lab results came back, and they confirmed what I had already announced last Sunday, that it was completely cancer-free. So that's wonderful. Also, I just want you to be in prayer for the people listed on our prayer list. One that I added this morning is a mother. Well, actually, we went to church with her too, but it's one of Dawn's co-workers. We went to church with them at Standardsville Baptist, but she's been diagnosed with cancer, and it's not looking good. Even with the option of chemotherapy, it only appears that buys just a little bit more time. And her name is Linda Koth. Her son is Stephen Koth. If you know them, or whether you don't know them, just keep them in prayer, please. And Pastor, Mary Ann improved any or still waiting on an answer?
About the same.
Okay. Well, if you would just take time to read this list over, keep these people in prayer, and be aware that there may be others in the congregation that just don't want the attention, but could sure use your thoughts and prayers. So we ask that you keep that in mind. We had a business meeting. Actually, it was our bigger annual business meeting this past Thursday night, where a budget was approved and different people to take different positions in the church was voted on. I'd like to encourage everybody. I'd love to see the attendance go up at these business meetings. And I'd like to encourage you, if you've been attending regularly but haven't become a member yet, I'd like to encourage you to do so. And if you are a member, or I'd just really like to see these business meetings be more attended. Everybody that is a member is part of this church family, and they do have a voice. And we'd like you to come out to these meetings and exercise that voice. And if you'll go with me now to our scripture reading, we are in Hebrews 12, verses 1 through 4. Give you just a moment. Hebrews 12, verses 1 through 4. Therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. You have not yet resisted to bloodshed, striving against sin. God bless the reading of his word. Go with me in prayer at this time. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for the freedom that we still enjoy to be gathered in your house. Father, we thank you for the souls you bring into this sanctuary. All of us are brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, we acknowledge the price paid by our Lord and Savior. Because of your grace that you showed to us. And Father, it wasn't that we earned it. In no way have we earned your grace or the forgiveness available in the blood of Jesus Christ. Father, the only way any of us can ever stand in your presence ever again is because we can be washed in Jesus' blood. And Father, we want to thank you. Father, we want to acknowledge the price that Christ paid on our behalf. And Father, we ask now that we know you're among us. We ask that your presence be felt. Please give the words and the message to our dear shepherd Mark as he comes to deliver your words today. And Father, we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you'll notice, sometimes we interrupt the program, right? And do it quite often. But there is one thing that I wanted us to do this morning. And as you know, this is Veterans Day weekend, where we remember those who have been willing to give their life and to defend our freedom, our opportunity. So I'm going to ask right now if our veterans would please stand up. And I want to do it in order. I think probably for the first time, we have no one who was World War II, right? What about Korean War? Vietnam? If you're in Vietnam, would you just stand up? When I realize that that's my age group and I see your age, that kind of concerns me a little bit. Okay. Then those who have served since, would you please stand if you have been a part of our military? You know, we enjoy a lot of freedoms in America. And we enjoy it because there are those who have been willing to give themselves in order that we might do that. So I want us, if we could, in order of showing our appreciation to them, that we would stand together and salute the flag that they fought under, that they gave themselves for, as we repeat the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Now, before you sit down, I would like to ask that we also have a special prayer. As you look at world scenes today, our world seems to be on fire. And many of the younger generation than us now are going to be called upon to serve. Many of them in harm's way. And so I want to ask you that we join in prayer that God give courage, give grace, give them salvation so that if they do give their life, they know where they're going, that we pray for those who need must fight after us. So if we would, let's bow our heads together. Our Father and our God, we bow before you and acknowledge that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. There would be no reason to live without you, but because you came, we have reason to live and to celebrate. And Father, we want to thank you for those who have willingly said that I will offer my life for my country and for my freedom and for the opportunity for us to worship God. I thank you, Father, for each one, and I pray your blessings upon them. But Father, we also pray for another generation, our children, our sons, our neighbors, our nephews, our acquaintance, who may be called upon to go to battle for us. Lord, let them not go without your protection and your peace. Make yourself known to them that they can know the salvation that we enjoy, that they know that no matter what happens, you're in charge and that you have saved their soul. Let them know our Christ and our Jesus, that they can have eternal life. And Lord, that you would protect them, that you give them peace, that you give them courage. We pray your protection upon them, and we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Brother Wilbur.
Hymn number 233, Jesus, keep me near the cross. Dear Heavenly Father, first I just want to thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for this church and just for being able to be in your presence today. Dear Heavenly Father, I would just like to ask that you would bless this offering, that you would bless it to your work, and that you would bless it to your hands. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Something, and today is no different. My calendar was dropped off this morning, and it's laying at the visitor center if you'd like to take a look at it. It's just a note to accompany it. I am getting this calendar that I photographed and put together to your church because your church building is featured as one of the lots. These calendars are available for sale at Cute. Is that how you say that?
Yeah.
Cute Scraps in Rubbersville. The price is $15 if you'd like to take a look at the one in the business.
It's about the cross. You know, we will be celebrating Christmas and all that goes around it. And I know you have a busy time ahead of you. You've got a lot of things that you're planning, a lot of things you're working on, anticipating. Don't forget to take time for Christ. Don't forget why I come and what it means to us. You know, as the world becomes secular, spending as much time, maybe more emphasis on Halloween than they are on Christmas now. We need to remember why he came and why he came for. I want to invite you to turn in your Bibles to the 9th chapter of the book of Luke. Luke chapter 9. And starting with verse 51, there is more of Luke that we'll be looking at, but I want us to start with verse 51. And it came to pass, when the time was come that he should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem, and sent messengers before his face, and they went and entered into a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. And they did not receive him, because his face was as though he would go to Jerusalem. And when his disciples and John saw this, they said, Lord, wilt thou that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elias did? But he turned and rebuked them and said, you know not what manner of spirit you are of, for the Son of Man has not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. And they went to another village. I find it to be face Jerusalem. Jerusalem has a lot of problems, and especially for Christ. Lazarus, when he had heard that he was sick, and Jesus said, let's go. And remember, Thomas said, Lord, if they go, they want to kill you. There's a hostility that he awaits when he gets to Jerusalem. But I want you to notice it said he set his face steadfastly to go to Jerusalem. And his disciples said, don't go. And I think most of us, if we were in that situation, would look at him and say, don't go. Don't go. But this is a path that has been determined before the foundation of the world. Peter said, for our lamb was slain before the foundation of the world, that this is where our hope of salvation is. If that be true, and God is God and in charge of all things, notice the path that has been set. Even at the very beginning with Adam and Eve, God said, Eve, I want you to understand, from your seed is going to come one who's going to suffer for mankind. He will have his heel bruised by Satan, but in the end, he will bruise his head. Noah, after the flood, offered sacrifices to God, reminding that world that now will be, after the destruction of that old world, that there's a lamb that's coming to take away the sin of the world. Abraham and the offering of Isaac, Moses as the Passover lamb, and through the ceremonial law that is given by God from Mount Sinai. Yes, each one tells us that there's a path that leads through Jerusalem. Well, what is it that awaits him in Jerusalem? Well, first of all, I think maybe one of the most hurting is a misunderstanding of those that love him. No one could really understand why we go to Jerusalem. And I'm not sure that they even understood really why he was going and what would take place when he got there. because those that loved him deserted him. And Jesus knew this because he knows all things. You know, we've all had to face trials and problems and difficulties. But we draw great comfort because of those that we love stand by us. But how much would it hurt if those that we counted the dearest forsook us in the time of our need, our trials, and our temptations? Yes. Jesus knew he would be deserted by his friends. He knew he would be betrayed by one of his disciples named Judas. You know, we often talk about how Jesus loved John. Do you know he loved Judas no less? Can you imagine one that you've chosen to be the closest and to do the most deserted you in your time of need? So for him to go to Jerusalem is to deal with those whom he loved who will turn his back on him. As he goes to Jerusalem, it's also a hostile city. They don't like Jesus. And we don't read very much about the first 3 years of the ministry of Christ. We read of his beginning. We read a little bit about what takes place, but mostly it's all about this last week that he lives upon earth when he goes to Jerusalem. He was despised and rejected of men. He was hated by those who really shouldn't have been hateful toward him. After all, the temple's in Jerusalem. The religious leaders are there. And he is the Son of God. Yet it was these religious leaders that seemed to hate him the most. Why? Because they did not like what he had to say. You see, religious people kind of get comfortable in their own religion and they kind of feel like, you know, we're right and everybody else is wrong. But the Son of God came and said, there's a flaw in your faith. You see, the Sadducees was one of the great groups in the temple, and they did not believe in life after death, any kind of spirituality. They did not believe in angels. They did not believe in anything beyond this grave. But Jesus said, God is the God of the living, not of the dead. And he taught that there is life, continuation of a soul after physical death. That no soul dies and that's it. There is those who will be in the Father's house and there's those who will be with Satan. There is heaven and there's hell. And they did not want to accept that. They didn't accept the fact that he talked about angels, that he talked about a God that's forever, that's unseen, yet is ruler of the universe. Well, if somebody challenges your beliefs and your doctrine, you're ready to fight, especially when your job is tied to it. And you understand that when Christ came and when the temple was fulfilled and needed no more, they're going to be out of work. No wonder they hated him. And then the Pharisees was also of the temple. Their situation was different. They believed in the spirit world. They believed that there was a life after death. They believed that there was a God in heaven. They believed in angels. But they believed the way to appease him was in rituality. That is, in what they did in a religious nature. They were all about being religious. They kept the law when they wanted to. You know, they tied down to the vegetables in their garden. And they prayed long prayers many times a day. They done a lot of things that was very religious. But yet, they rejected the Son of God when he came. It's been said that they were careful to wash their hands before they ate. but they didn't care to stand before the altar of God with a dirty heart. You know, I find, tragically, there's a lot of similarity in much of what is considered religion today in individuals. We want to keep all the churchy things. We want everybody to know how religious we are. But too often we appear before him with a dirty heart. Well, Jesus says what you think is what you are. Jesus said what's inside is what counts, not what's outside. Jesus said those publicans that you hate can become the children of God. And they hated him. The government hated him because they was afraid he was trying to start a kingdom. In fact, if you remember at his trial, the thing that the judge kept asking him, are you a king? Are you a king? He said, I'm a king, but it's not here now. Yes, he faced it a lot when he went to Jerusalem. He knew the cross was ahead. He steadfastly set his face to the cross. Now, most of us dread the unknown. And often when we are faced with a new challenge, we're kind of nervous and we worry about that. Sometimes even more troublesome is when we know what's ahead and we have to face it. You know, it was one thing to face surgery the first time because I didn't know what was going to happen. But what was worse, I knew what was going to happen and I faced it the second time. Maybe you've had that experience. When we know what lies ahead and we are fearful of it. Jesus knew what was ahead. He knew that he would be betrayed. He knew that he would sweat drops of blood in the garden. He knew that nails would be driven through his hands and his feet. He knew a crown of thorns would be on his brow. He knew that his back would be raw from the whip. He knew he would hang between heaven and earth and be ridiculed by men. He knew he'd be separated from the Father by our sins as he bore the sins of the world. He knew all of this, yet he set his face toward Jerusalem. Why? Why would he go and suffer those things that are so horrible? Because he saw beyond Jerusalem. He not only saw the cross, and he not only saw the grave, but he also saw the resurrection morning. He knew that God would not leave his soul in hell, that he would deliver him, that he was coming again. In fact, he said, you destroy this body, and in 3 days, I'll rise it again. I'm going to live after the cross. But more than that, he also knew that death on the cross would benefit those who hated him and who'd rejected him. I mean, it says here the Samaritans wouldn't entertain him because he was going to Jerusalem. They were that prejudiced. But yet, he said to his disciples before he left this earth, preach the gospel in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and the other parts of the earth. Even those that rejected him would now have hope because of his resurrection. He knew that the brighter day was coming. And folks, let me say this. He also knew that finally that heart of God that desired to be worshipped perfectly by those humans that he created on earth that he could have fellowship with one day would be perfected and with him in the Father's house. He said to the disciples, don't be discouraged. Don't be disheartened. You believe in God, believe also in me. In the Father's house are many mansions. And if it were so, I would have told you. But I'm going to prepare a place for you, and I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Now, I want you to think about something for a moment. He said that
to a group of people that he knew when he went to the cross would forsake him.
Right.
He knew that Peter, who was always mouthing off, one day would be cursing and denying that he ever knew him.
Right.
He said, I don't think this is. You're going to be with me in my Father's house. Hey, folks. He knew that the power of the blood of the cross could be able to clean up us sinful humans, that one day delivers from all of our sin, that we could be together with him in the Father's house. You see, he looked beyond Jerusalem. But folks, I think he also looked forward to a new Jerusalem. Isn't it interesting? He said in their prayers, you know, he said, when you pray, he said, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in heaven. And that's not what he said, was it? He said, my kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Do you think the world's ever experienced that? That we've actually seen the will of God done on earth as it is in heaven? But you know, one day we will. You see, he knew one day he was going to set his kingdom up in New Jerusalem. And I think sometimes we forget that before that eternal heaven that we read about in Revelation chapter 21, that before that, there is a time that we are going to be with Christ on earth for 1,000 years as he rules in Jerusalem. And this world for once will know peace in the Middle East and all over the rest of the world. And we all will be under the kingdom of God. His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus knew one day he would sit on his father David's throne. It's a promise that comes from God. So he knew the bad, but he could see beyond it. And because of what's beyond it, going through the cross is worthwhile. So what does he say to us? Follow me. It was interesting when he called his disciples. He didn't say, come help me build a kingdom. He didn't say, come help me start a new religion. I'm going to find a way to shut this thing once and for all. It keeps banging me in the knee. Okay. We got it shut. All right. But he didn't say all that. What did he say? Follow me. We are called to be followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you know what that means to follow? You go where he goes. Okay? You go where he leads. If you ever played follow the leader, if you didn't stay in step, you were out. Follow the leader. Follow me. Well, Lord, what's that mean? It means go with me through Jerusalem. Go with me through Jerusalem. Go with me, even if it costs rejection of those around you. Go with me, even if religion hates you. Go with me if the government destroys you. Follow me. Go with me, even if it costs your life. Go with me because you understand there's going to be a resurrection day. Understand there's going to be a heaven to gain and hell to lose. Follow me. That's interesting. If you read the rest of this chapter, after the Samaritans had rejected him, then there was a man that came along and said, Lord, I'll follow wherever you lead me. And Jesus said, the birds of the air have nests, the foxes have holes, the Son of Man hath nowhere to lay his head. Now, what's he saying? He said, if you're going to follow me, it's going to cost you. If you're going to follow me, you have to be willing to pay whatever price it costs. You know, one of the battles that we faced a couple years ago
was when the government threatened that if you were a nurse or a doctor or a law, you know, anybody involved in medical things, if you refused to participate in an abortion, you'd lose your job. It's interesting to watch people confronted with that reality. Thank God, you know, things were changed. But it may not be changed in the future. You may have to endorse things that are absolutely an abomination before God before you can continue in your employment. You may have to endorse homosexuality. You may have to endorse transgenderism. You may have to endorse all the rot and sin that's in this world to be employed. Jesus said, follow me, even to cost everything you've got. I enjoy the house that I live in, but if that house that I live in becomes more important to me than serving Jesus, I'm not worthy to follow him. I enjoy the comforts that God allows me to enjoy, but if providing them is more important than following Jesus, he said, you can't follow me. After that, another individual comes. He says, suffer me first to go bury my father. Suffer me to go bury my father. Now that sounds like a pretty decent request. After all, if he's got to have a funeral next day, expected to be there. But that's not what he's talking about. You see, by that tradition, to bury your father meant that you was going to maintain the care for the whole family until your father passed away. That you had a responsibility to your father as long as he was on this earth. Jesus said, family is important. You need to be aware of your family. God wants you to take care of your family. That's what he called you for. But if your family interferes with your walk with God, turn your back on your family. You know, it's hard, and I've known individuals had to do that, to be totally outcasts because they followed God. But they become outcasts. I've known families who belonged to another religion that turned their back on their children because they followed Christ. Guess what? It'll be worth it all when we see Jesus. And then another man came, and he said, Lord, I want to follow you, but let me go tell everybody goodbye. And Jesus said this, if you put your hand to the plows and turn back, you're not worthy of the kingdom of God. If you put your hand to the plow and turn back. Well, he's saying, first of all, if you start out plowing and you don't, you know, it's not the intention, you give up, you're not worthy of the kingdom of God. But it's also saying something else. When you put your hand to the plow, keep your face toward Jerusalem. Keep your faith in walking with Jesus. Now, I know a lot of you are city folk, some of you. Maybe you don't quite understand plow. But I want you to know, I know how to plow. Okay? And I remember learning. I remember when I first climbed on that old Massey Ferguson, and Dad trusted me to plow. And I was always hoping that I was doing right, and I'd always look behind me to make sure. And every time I did, I got out of where it's supposed to be, right? In fact, if you look back instead of forward, you're just going to make a mess. Only as I learned to look where I was going instead of where I've been, could I plow a straight furrow. Paul said,
Forgetting those things which are behind, I press onward toward the prize of the mark of the high calling. Jesus said, if you're going to follow me, we're going forward, not backward. So here's some things I think he's saying to us. Number one, forget the guilt. Forget the guilt. God has given you a new life. God has given you a new hope and a new path. Walk in it with pride. Walk in it following Christ. It doesn't do any good to worry about what was. Folks, listen, it's practical, but it's a reality. You can't unscramble eggs. I don't care what you've done in the past. You can't undo it. You can't make up for it. You can't make it right. But I want to tell you what, no matter what's happened in the past, you can walk forward with Jesus. Walk forward with Jesus. Walk forward with Jesus. Forget the victories in the past. You know, I don't care what you've done for Jesus last year, you still have a new year to go. I don't care what happened yesterday, you got today.
Amen.
We can't live off of yesterday's blessings.
That's right.
I don't care what great things happen in this church and this people, it's not enough. We got to keep walking forward. We got to find our Jerusalem and walk through it. You see, Jesus knew that Jerusalem was going to be doomed because he said, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how oft would I gather you together so he gathers the chicks and you would not? Do you know Jesus wants to gather Rutgersville? He said, I love it. I love every person in it. I love the up and up and the down and outs. I love the good, the bad, and the ugly. I love them all. And I want them to know me. Jesus wants us to be gathering them up. Jesus wants me to be taking care of them. So that means walking forward. We got to care and love for those that Jesus loved. Understand that looking forward is what needs to be done. Looking forward knows where you want to go. Jesus said, I want my purpose to be your purpose. Follow me. As I have loved the people, as I have been willing to die for the people, as I've been willing to go through Jerusalem for the people, I want you to be willing to also. You know, isn't it a shame the reason we don't witness is because we're afraid? Somebody might laugh at us. Somebody may reject us. Somebody may think we're bothering them. Jesus loved them enough to die for them. Follow me. Follow me. Let's pray together. Our Savior and our Lord, our God that created us and made us in his own image and his own likeness, our God who knew every sin and every mistake we ever made in life, and yet loved us enough to come to this world, to die on a cross, to suffer all the ills, that we could have life and have it abundantly. I can't understand that love, Father, but thank you. Lord, I want to ask you, would you give me strength to follow Jesus? Lord, when I get weary, give me strength. When I get stubborn, break my heart to follow you. Lord, when I veer off the path, by your Spirit, by your correction, whatever it takes, bring me back that I'll walk with you. I'm thankful that Jesus walked to Jerusalem for me. Lord, give me grace and strength to walk through Jerusalem for him. Let us see what you have for us. Lord, have your way here this morning. Speak to our hearts. Prepare them as we sit at your table. May your will be done. And we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. I will make a couple practical applications. Number one, in life you're going to face some difficult times. see the benefit after the trial. And always remember that there is nothing that you'll ever go through that's worth more than heaven. You know, Jesus, if he just looked at what was going to happen there, he may back down. But he looked to the well done of his Father. He looked to heaven itself. Therefore, he set his face to Jerusalem. I challenge you. We have all the difficulties and all the challenges of being a Christian. It may not be easy to be a Christian in America anymore. But I want to tell you, heaven's as sweet as it ever was. God's promise of life is sure and steadfast. So let's follow him in all that we do. Do we stand as we sing together? The song says, beneath the cross I'll take my stand. That we'll bear the cross. Jesus said, if you follow me, take up your cross and follow me. He's saying, I'm going to walk in the light of the cross and the victory of an empty tomb. I would challenge you, if you've never walked with Jesus, he says, do you follow me? Come follow me. Do yield yourself to walk where I walk. Understand that I went to the cross for you. I died that you could have life and have it abundantly. I knew you from the beginning, and it was you in my mind when I went to the cross. I trust you, Jesus. Jesus, I want to receive you. I want to trust you as my Savior. I want to challenge you to purpose in your heart that no matter what happens in these days ahead, I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to follow Jesus as we sing together.
Hymn number 238, Beneath the Cross.
Thank you.
privilege of those who have bought the blood of Christ is the privilege to set the kingdom at his table. I know this is just a representation of what was and what shall be. But how can we ever take the Lord's Supper and not remember that he promised one day he would eat with us anew in the Father's kingdom? That our eternity secure, our hope is a reality. One day in the Father's house. Together, we sit and are united in Christian love. But most of all, we're united again afresh with Christ in a new sense, a new way of what he paid for us and what he's promised us. Together as we take the Lord's Supper. Brother Wayne, would you ask a blessing?
Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you this morning to celebrate a risen Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord. We thank you for our opportunity this morning, Father, to partake of this communion meal together. We know, Father, that the broken body of Christ is that bread of life. And we thank you, Father, we're going to partake of that bread now as we remember the day that Jesus broke the bread to his disciples and said, take eat, this is my body. Do this in remembrance of me. Yeah. We ask that now, Father, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. Jesus took bread and broke it and blessed it, said, "Take eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This is the remembrance of me." Did like matter also. Jesus took the cup after his supper, saying, "Drink you all of this, for this represents the New Testament that is in my blood, which is shed for many." So often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you just show the Lord's death until he comes. Great promise in the Word of God. As Jesus said, "If I go away, I will come again to see you and myself. That is our promise. That is our amen. Would you stand for us?
Come to you today, Lord, and Lord, just blessed to hear your word, blessed to be here. Dear Heavenly Father, I just would like to ask that we would not keep your word a secret. Lord God, allow us to take your word into the world, to stand in courage, knowing that you are with us, knowing that you go before us, knowing that you have ordained every relationship and every moment of this week that is coming. Lord God, again, thank you for this church. Thank you for your sacrifices, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, thank you.